Hi, you join me today at the brilliant Todber Manor Fisheries. It's coming into springtime, at least I think it is. So I just thought I'd run you through a few simple tactics for springtime and catching carp on the pole in the spring. Coming into spring, they sort of change their feeding habits a little bit, and my rigs and baits and how I feed them changes. So I thought I'd run you through a few different methods, just hopefully catch you more fish in the spring. Right, before we get started, I'm going to run you through what bait selection I've got with me, how I've prepared it, and what gear I've got set up. So first of all, the bait selection. In winter, especially on fisheries like this, I might be fishing corn, meat, not feeding a lot, probably feeding through a pot like this, although I still probably will start the session on a pot like this. It's going to be more about pellets and probably using this instead, a catapult, just making the noise, ringing the dinger bell. In springtime, they're sort of looking for a bit more feed and they will respond more to noise and feed hitting the water. So that's why I've definitely got pellets with me. I've got some 4 and 6 mil pro feed pellets. Don't need a lot of feed this time of year. It's just about ringing the dinger bell. Still not piling lots of baits in, but you know, little and often, you know, like they always say, is, you know, really is key this time of year. So they're the most important bait for me this time of year. I'll be looking to fish that on the long pole, maybe ping a few pellets, maybe start on a short pole to begin with, catch what I can, and then maybe later on in the session come back to that line. But I can also change those lines to, you know, meat and corn and play it by ear and see what's working on the day. Later on in the session, fish do switch on to baits like meat and corn, depending on the fishery. Here at Todber Manor, they really do like, or respond well to feeding meat. So that's a key bait to have with me. I've got some 7 mils there, also got some banoffee corn, also brilliant hook baits for fishing down the edge. And while we're speaking about the edge, I've got some 2 mil pellets, kept it really simple. Pro feed again, just soak them up, just so there's enough water to cover them, and then I've left them overnight in a bag and they're good to go in the morning. Right, so they're the baits that I'm going to be feeding today. I'm going to run you through quickly some hook bait options. Now, on the short line and the long line, when I'm feeding hard pellets, I will look to fish what I'm feeding basically. It's what they're used to picking up, so it makes sense to fish a hard pellet on the hook. So I'll either be, you know, feeding 4s and maybe fishing a 6, a bigger standout bait on the hook, or just exactly what I'm feeding, fish 4s on the hook and feed 4s, likewise with 6 mils. Which size I feed depends on the response I get. I mean, I could start the session on 4 mils. If I think there's a few sort of skimmers in the peg, I can switch it up to 6 mils, and that's a bit more resilient, and you know, you're gonna hopefully get through to some better fish doing that. Down the edges, like I said before, nice standout cube of meat or a grain of corn, maybe double corn if there's a lot of fish in the peg. And I've also got some maggots, you know, a brilliant bait for fishing down the edge. 3, 4, even 5 of them on the hook is brilliant. Nice standout, but light bait that they can eat easily. So they're my hook bait options. Now I'm going to run you through my rigs quickly. Really simple. Let's see what we've got set up. So let's quickly run you through the rigs I've got set up. I've only got 3 rigs, really simple. I've got 11 hollow on the open water lines. Obviously I can swap and change to a 13 in the middle of the session if I think there's a lot of fish in the peg or there's bigger fish. But for small carp and sort of all round commercial, 11 hollow is brilliant. I've got a nice durable main line, 017 power line. I've actually got a new float, which is a Carp XS. The key thing about this float is it's got a really thick hollow bristle tip that I can see out on that long line. It's also got a glass stem, which is nice and stable. It's really windy and a bit horrible today, so that'll be nice and stable in that blustery wind. So I've got a 2 backshot there to help keep it still as well. And then all the rigs today are really simple. Initially, I've just got a bulk of shot like that. Just got some stots, and I've got 2 droppers on this line. Obviously, I can swap and change as the session goes on. If there's a lot of fish in the peg, I'll keep it as a bulk and maybe 1 dropper or 2 droppers. But if they are sort of coming up in the water for feed, I will spread it out as long as I'm not getting too many bites, I'll spread it out, and that way you can catch those fish on the drop, and, you know, on those harder days, that can get you a few extra bites and possibly some bigger fish sometimes. You quite often find that the bigger fish sort of take it on the drop because they know they can't get caught that way. So that's a little play it by ear, see what happens, see what the fish want. But initially, just really simple, bulk, two droppers on this rig. And then because I'm going to be fishing hard pellets on this rig, I've got 013 to a size 16 GPM with a band on the hair. Like I said before, rigs are really adaptable, so even if I decide to fish meat or any other bait like that, I can swap my hook length over, put like, let's say a 14XXH and fish a big cube of meat on. But again, fishing this time of year is all about sort of trial and error, seeing what the fish want and seeing what they want on the day, because it is changing a lot this time of year. So same again, so I didn't say that was a 414 float on that long line because it is windy today. But on the shorter line, I've got a similar rig. Because it's a bit more shelter closer in, I've got a 4x12. So, you know, it's probably about 5 foot deep, nice 4x12 float. Really stable tip on that. It's going to be a bit of tow today, but that's not going to get dragged under in this wind. And then finally, I've got a margin rig set up. Again, it's another new float. There are times this time of year when there are a lot of fish in your peg, and having a really thick bristle can be brilliant. So this is an Edge XS. It's got a slightly thicker bristle, again a glass stem, really, you know, durable when you're catching a lot of fish. Hopefully we'll catch a few fish today. But that's a really durable rig. Again, I've got a back shot because it's horrible windy today. Really simple again, bulk, one dropper, and this time I've got a 14XSH that I can, you know, hook a grain of corn, cube of meat or a bunch of maggots, like I said before. We're going to be probably feeding micro pellets there, but again, we're going to experiment. If there are a lot of fish in the peg, I'll probably move to heavier baits like meat and corn, just to stop them wafting it around. But, you know, at the moment it is a bit cold. Hopefully we'll get a few bites in the edge, and I think the micros will probably be about right. So there are my rigs, baits. Let's see if we can catch a few fish. Right, so let's start the session. Now, the first line I tend to start on most commercials is a short line. Quite a few reasons for that. Obviously, I can feed that line before I go on and feed the other swims. I can look around at the anglers around me, see what they're feeding, see how the fish respond, and I can sort of make my mind up on how to fish the other swims before I could potentially ruin them really with the wrong baits or feeding too much too little. But today I'm going to start off with a 6mm on the band, just like that. I'm going to put on a small cab pot. I'm literally going to put half a dozen 6mm, well, fours actually to begin with, 4mm pellets onto the pot. Just a small tiny amount of bait, just going to dip it in the water that so it doesn't spill out the pot. Tiny amount of bait to begin with, just a little trap, see if there's any fish close in. Obviously on commercials, they get fish regularly and people sort of chuck their bait in from the day before, and you quite often find that even in sort of early on in the year, there are a few fish close in to be caught. So just going to tip the pot over. I've actually plumbed up a line about 6 meters out, just a reasonable distance away from me initially, because we are making a bit of noise on the bank, and it is sort of, the water's still cold, so I'm expecting the fish to be sort of further out, if you like, to begin with. And hopefully as the day warms up, they will sort of start feeding a bit more, come a bit closer. So I'm just looking at my float, seeing if there's any liners, indications. I think that was a little line bite then. It's actually towing quite a bit today. Right to left, where the wind's sort of swinging around and the tow's picking it up. So, something to sort of keep your eye on, really. Even though I've picked a marker on the far bank and I've fed that one swim on that, in line with that marker, that tow will actually carry that bait down the peg a little bit. So it's worth letting the rig sort of run through with the bait and sort of see where you get the bites, because that'll often be where the feed is. That was a little indication there. So there might be a few fish about. Obviously, I'm not expecting a manic start this time of year. It's just about picking a few fish off to begin with. Catching a few fish when I can and keeping the bites coming by rotating different lines. But I'm going to stick with it on this line and hopefully I'll come back to you when I've had a bite. So I've actually missed a bite, a couple indications, and then I've waited. So what I'm going to do now is actually throw a few 6mm and try and draw any fish that were there back again. Feeding them slightly to the right because it is towing really hard today. And that wind is making it a bit awkward. So although I'm making a bit of noise with throwing pellets, I'm still going to feed through the pot to try and retain a bit of accuracy because the wind's just a nightmare today. But that's the sort of things you got to deal with when you're fishing in this country, unfortunately. Lots of wind, rain. Hopefully just ringing that dinghy bell, pellets hitting the water, just sort of spurs a few fish into feeding, if you like. Just so they know it's there. So I mentioned before about the float I'm using today. It's actually working quite well because it's towing really hard on this short line. But because I've got that thick bristle, it's sort of staying on the surface and stopping it dragging under. Obviously, I'm not expecting it to tow quite so hard when I'm fishing long, just because of the way the wind is. But still, when you're fishing long, especially when it's a bit dull like it is today, it really helps having that bristle showing. So you know, when that float goes under, it's a bite. There's no sort of uncertainty. You can see every sort of indication. You can dot it right down if you like. And likewise, if there are a lot of fish in the peg, you can take a shot off. I normally have a few trimming shots, say a few number 12s up the line stops, and I can take those off quite easy and have a bit more bristle showing. Likewise, I can keep them dotted down like it is on this short line. It's just a nice little dimple there, but it's not getting dragged under in the tow, which is important really, especially when you're fishing in conditions like this. Your rig needs to be set right and you need to be able to see every bite. So there's a bite. I think it's the wrong species though. But skimmers are still wake builders. It's nice to see a few fish in the peg at least. I think what I might do, just to try and give myself more of a standout bait, hopefully if there are any carp in the peg, is to just use the same hook bait setup. I've got a band on here, but I'm actually going to use a baiting needle with a hook on. I'm actually going to try a cube of meat on that hair just to sort of grab the attention of any carp. Obviously I'm feeding pellets, but you can still fish meat and other baits on the hook. So there we go, nice hairy piece of meat, just using the band. Like before, still going to feed pellets. I think what I'll do this time is put 6mm in the pot, because there are obviously some skimmers there. And we'll see if this makes a difference. I think it's going to be a bit more resilient to any silverfish that are there. And make sure there is at least some bait in the peg with a few 6mm. And obviously I've got that slightly bigger hook bait on the hook. Hopefully it makes a difference. Obviously, I don't mind catching skimmers like that. I mean, that was probably over a pound, so it's worth catching anyway. But just little changes like this can make all the difference sometimes. Again, I've fed that bait through the pot, but I'm gonna just feed two or three pellets around the float. Just make a bit of noise. Obviously, it's not gonna be very accurate, but it's just gonna let them know that there's a bit of feed there. Little indication there. So even though I've not caught a carp straight away, I'm just gonna give it a bit of time just to make sure that I've given it a go, and sort of if there are any fish short, I've had a go at catching them before I go on the longer line or down the edge. Just try and make most of your swim and plan your route depending on what's happening. I mean, you could go on this short line and catch there all day some days. Oh, that was a line bite. Lost me a bit of meat. So I'm gonna do the same again. Might have been that a few carp come in the peg. Another cube of meat. And because I had a line bite then, I'm not actually gonna feed this time. I'm gonna go straight in, see if he's still there. I won't give it too long before feeding again though, but just sort of see if there's a fish there before I feed on top of his head. And see if we can get a quick bite. It's all about letting the fish tell you what's going on. I've had that line bite then, so I know there's fish in the peg. Just gonna give it a bit of time. See if it's still there. If they're not, I feed again and try and draw them back in again. So I could start thinking about feeding my other line as well. Could ping a few pellets out further. But if you know I start catching on meat on this short line, then I could even just sort of cab pot meat out long and be patient and wait for bites like that. But it's getting into springtime now, and ideally I do want to fish pellets because they do respond to pellets this time of year. See, I've not had any indication since, so I'm gonna come back, put a bit of bait in the pot. See if we can draw a few fish back over the spot. Set a little trap up again. So half a dozen 6mm pellets into the pot. Still got the meat on the hook. It's been nice and accurate. It's difficult today because it is towing a lot. It's hard to judge where the bait's going. I'm just going to feed it slightly to the right of where I ideally want to be fishing, where I've plumbed up. Just let that bait fall. Hopefully, it'll be where my hook bait is. Keep on throwing a few pellets as well. Not too many. 3 pellets there over the float. That's just enough to get a response sometimes. Obviously, I've fed that bait, and that bait's hopefully sitting on the bottom there, underneath. There we go. So that's a carp. Might have responded to that bait hitting the water. Just sort of come in, had a look. Found my bait on the bottom. My big standout hook bait there. And we're into a decent fish. So I've got 11 hollows, really soft. Just take my time, make every fish count. Obviously I've hooked that fish, so what I'm gonna do, because he seemed to come to a bit of bait, I'm gonna carry on flicking a few pellets out there. Hopefully when I do go out there, there's another one waiting for me. It's just about catching what I can to begin with. And then obviously we've got our other lines to move on later. Yeah, nice fish. immaculate condition Todber Manor carp. Nicely hooked. Probably not going to let me hold him up, but I'll just show you it. It's quite a pretty fish. There we go. Typical Todber Manor carp, immaculate condition. See if we can catch another one. Right, so I've caught that one fish. I've gone straight back over the top. Again, sort of half a dozen 6 mils. Hopefully there's another one there waiting for me. Little liner there straight away. So there's obviously a few fish that have started to find my bait, so it's encouraging. So it's springtime, the water's still cold, so it can take a little time for fish to start feeding. Hopefully this short line will come good now and we'll catch a few fish before we start messing around and doing other things like the long pole and down the edge. I'm hoping, obviously I'm expecting most of the fish to come on that long pole, but I'm hoping that short line and margins will be quite good later. Because obviously it's still a match venue and, you know, anglers throw the bait in at the end. They do know that there's going to be bait in the margins at the end of the day. And that's the sort of time when you do sort of start to target those lines. But it's nice to catch a few fish short initially. It is still freezing cold, so it's nice to just to be out and getting a few bites. So we've had a fairly decent start. I think we'll give this line another 5, maybe 10 minutes. If we don't start catching properly, then we'll move on to the other lines and, you know, keep fish coming. If it's a match, you've got to look at sort of what your catch rate is. And if you're not catching enough on one line, you've got to swap and change and try and make things happen. So we'll give it a bit longer and then I'll be moving on to my longer line. So there we go, there's another fish on the short line. Actually, I had to wait a little longer that time, so I think what I'm going to do, I'm going to take what I've learned from this short line. Obviously, that noise was important. Feels like a decent fish, actually. That noise was important. So I'm going to land this fish and go on the long line, but while I'm playing this fish, I'm actually going to ping a few pellets out there. Just like before, make a little bit of noise. That way when I do land this fish, hopefully there's a few fish further out waiting for me. This feels like a big fish actually, I'm going to take my time with this. Could even be a catfish, there's a few catfish in here. So got 11 hollow, stretches for miles, so I'm going to just take my time with it. Slowly use the side puller to bring it back. It's coming in now, to be fair. But if it was taking a long time, obviously I can keep catapulting a bit of bait just to set myself up for the next fish. And quite often find that the fish on this short line are a bigger sort of stamp of fish, so it's worth being a bit more patient at times. There we go, that's a decent fish, that one. Yeah, it's worth being a little bit more patient because quite often find that bigger fish like this can be found closer in. So it's probably 7-8 pound, that one. A bit lively. So it was worth waiting for, but let's see if we can catch on that long line now. Put that rig down. Pick me other rig up from a longer line, slightly heavier float. Cab pot like before. I'm just gonna do exactly what I was doing short. So pinged a few pellets now. I'm gonna ping a few more out there. Got a marker there, so I don't need to be really accurate. It's just sort of making a bit of commotion in the area. Like before, I'm going to start on pellets. on the hook, half a dozen in the pot, just to be nice and accurate, because it is windy and horrible today, but not very spring-like, but hopefully the fish know it's spring. So, because it's windy, I've just opted to fish about 30 metres, so another three sections on. Obviously that gives me room to go a little bit further if I am struggling. Sometimes you find that the fish sort of hang beyond your bait a little bit. I was expecting this line to be quite productive really, so I've got that marker there. What I'm going to do is turn the pot over, nice and accurate, and lower my rigging in amongst it. A slightly heavier float this time. Just sitting there nicely, nice really thick hollow bristle. Hopefully we get a few indications there. I'll sit and be patient, see if a few fish come to those few pellets, but if nothing happens in sort of a minute or two, I'll pick up the catapult and ping two or three pellets over the top. Just making a bit of noise, but you're not piling loads of bait in, which is important this time of year, because they're not feeding lots, but they are sort of starting to wake up a little bit. And whereas in winter they didn't really respond to bait hitting the water, in this time, making a little bit of noise, just trickling a few pellets in little and often can make all the difference. So we'll see if we can get a bite, and then we'll pick the catapult up and try and make something happen. So I've potted those baits in, given it a couple minutes. I've not had an indication, so all I'm going to do is pick up my catapult. Three or four pellets in the pot, or the pouch. The wind's making it a bit awkward. I'm going to just be as accurate as I can, like before. A few pellets around the float. Also, I've already fed through the pot, so I should have a bit of bait around my hook bait as a bit of a target point for the fish to home in on. But I've also got that bit of noise of the pellets hitting the water. So this has attracted a seagull, but hopefully it's attracted a few carp as well. I've got a seagull out there waiting for me to feed again. But he's gone now. Yeah, hopefully making a bit of noise. Just lets fish know the feed's there. Just a bit more attraction to the peg. And hopefully it'll stir them into feeding. So now that we've gone on to this long line, it's actually surprisingly difficult. It's just a bit of a reminder that it is still cold. But I've sat there sort of 5-10 minutes with no indications. Oh, there's a little indication then, a little bite. So all I did is I come back and I filled my pot sort of half full with a few 2 mils, squashed it down, shipped out and tapped that out there. It's not something I like to do in deep water too often as a fish. But it can just draw a few fish in your peg, like this one. And then what you can do is you can feed over the top again with your 6 mils. And those 2 mils have just sort of drawn the fish in the peg. They're sort of a bit smellier, they're soft, they're easy to eat. And they really do work in drawing a few fish in your peg. But it's not something you really want to do in deep water too often, because you can cause, you know, a lot of line bites. They can waft it around too much and they become hard to catch. But when bites are hard to come by, just by introducing a few 2 mils into the peg, can definitely draw a few fish in. And I think that's what's happened now. I've gone there, been patient, not had any bites, so I fed some 2 mils. And we've got a few fish like this in the peg now. It's definitely worked. But I can go back to fishing hard pellets then, once a few fish have found the feed. Again, that's the reason why I'm feeding 2 mils down the edge, or I will be later on anyway, because there's so much attraction in them. It's not necessarily a bait that you'd want to use in the summer when there's a lot of fish around, but it definitely draws a few fish in your peg when the water's still cold and bites are sometimes hard to come by. It's a nice little mirror carp there. Hopefully there's a few fish mooching around now. Again, while I'm back here, I'm gonna ping a few pellets in the peg, set myself up for another fish, and hopefully we start catching a few now. But yeah, it's encouraging, two drops virtually, and yeah, it's looking good now. So hopefully we catch a few more fish on this, and then we have a little look down the edge later on for hopefully some bigger fish, and hopefully we carry on catching. So there's another fish. It's quite interesting then. I went a little bit quiet and I put a few fours into the pot as well. It seemed to draw them back in again. But I think this line's been really good now, and it's coming sort of towards the end of the session, and I'm thinking about fishing my edge line now. I've actually plumbed up two margins, one to the left, one to the right. And I think because I've had quite a decent response from pellets out long, I'm going to stick with it and be really simple and just feed micro pellets. But I think the difference between my left and my right hand margin, I'm probably going to feed one side with sort of a decent pot, maybe half a big pot, and then the other side I'll keep negative. And oh, I've lost that one. Never mind, like you do. Yeah, so that was what I was saying. I think I'll feed one side quite negatively. In fact, I'll do it now. So I've got my 2mm pellets here. I'm just gonna feed one side, probably just a palm full, probably like a big kinder pot full. I'll feed that in one side. I'll put a decent amount in on the other. That just sort of hedges my bets and see what the fish want, really. Yeah, if I fed both swims really positively and it wasn't right on the day, then it sort of ruins my chances. But I've got my marker there. I'm going to be really nice and accurate. Tip them out there. So that's going to be my negative line. And then on the other side, I'm going to be a bit more generous with it. I'm going to feed half a pot full there. Plenty of bait, probably too much bait to be fair, but if the fish are sort of really having a bit of a feed and looking for lots of bait at the end of the session, then it gives me a chance of catching. If I don't catch this side, it's not the end of the world. I'll pick my marker again, so there's two trees there, so tip it over nice and accurately. I think because I fed that one side negatively as well, I'm going to go straight in over the top of that, because there is a chance that there are a few fish in there straight away, and there's not too much bait there now. There is a good chance that I might actually catch a few fish straight away, so I'm going to pick up my margin rig. Obviously, if this was a match, I could keep pinging my long line as well, but we're coming to the end of the session now anyway. So I'm going to slide on a 7mm cube of meat on that one. I will put a cad pot on this as well, but because I've just fed, I won't bother until my next go. Just see if we get any liners straight away. If we don't get any liners, I can put the little pot on, keep introducing a bit of bait, keep trying to draw the fish in. It's important not to feed too much this time of year, because it is, again, just sort of still setting traps of one or two fish. You're not trying to draw loads of fish in like you are in the summer, sort of big potting ground bait and stuff. It's just important to be nice and patient, set a little trap up. So what I've done here, I've actually come away from the bank a little bit to where it's about 3 foot deep. It's actually quite nice and flat, so my bait's not going to be wafted around too much. Quite a nice flat hard area, but importantly it's in slightly deeper water. I mean, we're not in the into summer yet, where it's really coloured. And those fish are a little bit more reluctant to come in when it's a bit clearer, like it is today. I mean, in the summer, you might only need to fish sort of a top kit or on the end of your nets on this sort of venue. There are a lot of fish in here, but at this time of year, it's worth fishing a little bit further away from you. So I've gone 5 metres one side and 6 metres the other. Just keeps a bit more distance between you and the fish. We're making a bit of a noise today, talking. It's not ideal. But we've gone a bit further away from myself. I've gone out from the bank in the deeper water and hopefully they'll be a bit more comfortable there. Hopefully we'll get one or two bites to finish on. So there's a line bite there. Just moved my rig a little bit, so I'm going to drop it right back over the feed again. Hopefully we get a bite. So that's encouraging, so I've only just fed it really. I think if it was a match, I'd probably feed it, stay out on my long line, catch a few, maybe top up a couple times, get the confidence going before I start fishing it. But I fed that bait and I've had that definite line bite from a carp. So I think what I'll do now is, if I don't have a bite in another couple minutes, I put a little pot on and set another trap in. And hopefully it'll draw those fish back in again. Because there wasn't an awful lot of bait there, but it might just be that one's come in, have a look. You just need to get their confidence going. Obviously I've fed a lot more bait on the other side, so I can leave that alone. Hopefully get their confidence up. But I've got a feeling it's not going to be too long till we get a bite. There's another line bite. Float just moves sideways slightly. I think there's one just come in the peg. Also, I've got that big bristle there. It's dotted right down at the minute. Ooh, there we go. That's a tiny little bite. Obviously, with that thick bristle, I could see everything. Just going to take my time. I've got 13 hollow on. So if I do hook a massive fish, I've got plenty of power. I'm going to take my time, get this fish in. And then I'll just repeat the process. Small cab pot. Nice and simple, fill it with 2mm pellets. And I fed the other side more positively, so I've got the option of trying that side as well, but I don't necessarily need to feed it as often. So it's just about seeing what the fish want. And if there are a lot of fish coming in the margins, this sort of little trap setting with a small cab pot can be really effective. Just fishing for one fish at a time. And as you can see by that, it's a slightly bigger fish, so it's well worth waiting for. So I didn't make too much disturbance there. So hopefully when I go back in again. In fact, what I might do is actually feed first before I put a hook bait on. Just gives it a bit more time for the fish to come back in again. So straight back in. Cab put full of 2mm, nice and accurately, same spot again. Under the water. Come back in again, put my hook bait back on. So a nice 7mm piece of meat again. Also could try corn or maggots, but we've caught that one fish now, so no reason not to change. I've already fed my bait this time, so I'm going to go straight back in over the top. Hopefully it doesn't take too long. Like I said before, I am fishing in sort of 3 foot of water. I did have quite a few liners before that, so I mean, if it was the case that my bait was getting wafted around and I wasn't hooking fish. I could plumb up again into shallower water, but I've got a feeling this depth is about right, really. The water's still quite clear. As long as I don't get too many line bites, it should be about right, really. Then you could go the other way. I mean, if you weren't getting bites on this line, you could plumb up in, say, 4 foot, just where the fish feel a bit more confident, maybe. It's all about trial and error, really, and finding out what the fish want. It could be different every day. I mean, we could have a day with bright sunshine tomorrow and they might want to go in really shallow water. It's all about experimenting and seeing what they want. There we go, that didn't take too long. It's a good sign, that is. Hopefully we'll get a good run of fish now to finish the session off. I mean, now I'm catching on this left-hand margin, there's no real need to try the other way of feeding a big pot in. This just seems to be working. But on the other hand, feeding that right-hand edge left off less often, it just gives me an opportunity, you know, and if bites do dry up on this left-hand edge, I can drop in there. And there might be a few fish there waiting for me. So, just keeps my options open by feeding two different ways. Not so much of a big fish that time, but plenty of time to catch a few big ones. So, same again. Piece of meat on the hook, a few tuning wheels in the pot, set myself up another little trap, nice and accurately, taking my time, make sure it feeds in the right spot. And I can lower that hook bait in, straight in amongst it. If there were a lot of fish in the peg, you might find that the fish follow that feed down and you get a bite straight away. But there you go, well, like that. So there obviously are a few fish about. It's definitely the way to go. Little cab pot on the end of the pole. No need to feed lots of bait this time of year. It's just about keeping bait coming through. Set myself a nice little trap there. And if this was a match, I'd be on to a good weight and a good finish. That's a bigger fish this time. That's definitely the fish we're looking for when we're down the edge. There we go. Probably 8 or 9 pound that fish. So well worth waiting for, although we didn't have to wait too long for that fish. Ooh, a bit lively, we're putting back nice and quietly. Hopefully we can get one or two more fish to finish the session. Oh, there's another fish, come straight to the feed, that one. As much as I want to stay and catch these fish at Todber, I think we'll call that one the last fish. It's been a brilliant session. Hopefully, I've passed on a few tips, a few to help you catch a few springtime carp. another nice little mirror there. Ooh. As much as I want to stay and catch these fish, I think it's time to go home. In the dry, hopefully you've picked up a few hints and tips to help catch you some of these springtime carp. Don't forget to like and subscribe to Preston YouTube channel, and hopefully we'll see you next time.